You've probably heard of them before, right? They're used everywhere, from sports like cycling, Formula One, and even in the design of planes and cars. But not all wind tunnels are born equal. They range from small to big, fast to slow, and everything in between.
So does the wind tunnel replicate the flow that we experience in everyday life? If you consider a wind tunnel setting, let's say, the model is usually stationary and the fluid is moving. But in everyday life, like when you're moving in a car or if you're in an aeroplane, the object, that is the car or the aeroplane, is moving and the fluid is usually stationary, provided there is no wind.
So what makes a wind tunnel different?
Hi, I'm Nikhilesh.
And I'm Kushal. We're the two broke scientists.
What is a wind tunnel? Simply put, a wind tunnel is a tube or a building that has air flowing through it. The basic principle behind a wind tunnel is to match the relative speed between the object and the air with what you would expect in real life. Notice that I said relative, which means that the absolute velocity of either the object or the wind does not matter, as long as you maintain the difference between both of them the same in the wind tunnel. The interaction between the fluid and the object only depends on the relative speed, which is why it doesn't matter if the object is stationary and air is going past it, or if the air is still and the object moves into it.
Wind tunnels are classified based on their speed of operation and the test section sizes. For the speed of operation, the classification is done based on Mach number. If the Mach number of the flow is less than 0.8, the wind tunnel is considered as a subsonic wind tunnel. And if the Mach number lies between 0.8 and 1.2, it's considered as a transonic wind tunnel. And supersonic wind tunnels are tunnels where the velocity of the fluid is above 1.2, which means the fluid velocity is at least a minimum of 1.2 times the speed of sound. Wind tunnels also vary greatly in terms of test section sizes. The wind tunnel at NASA Ames Research Facility can accommodate full-scale aircrafts, and in some cases, the test section size is as small as a few centimeters square in area.
But even with wind tunnels that operate in the same speed regime and have the same test section size, the construction can be different. The test section can be bounded on all sides with walls, called a closed test section, or it can be left open to the atmosphere, called an open jet test section. Also, the air that is used in the wind tunnel can either be recycled or it can be thrown out to the atmosphere.
What are the different parts of a wind tunnel? In a wind tunnel, we have...
Hold on.
Why?
Can't we do all this explaining using a real wind tunnel?
Do you want to go to NASA?
No, but our university is just a hop, skip and a jump away.
Alright, let's go!
We are at the high-speed laboratory of the Delft University of Technology. Here, we have a lot of wind tunnels, ranging from a subsonic, supersonic and a transonic wind tunnel. Now, let's show you around.
To the low-speed wind tunnel, what we call as the W tunnel. The W tunnel is an open-circuit, low-speed wind tunnel. And as we told you before, wind tunnels can be classified based on three criteria: the speed at which they operate, the turbulence intensity, which I'll talk about in a bit, and the test section area. So here you see, this test section area is about 40 cm by 40 cm squared, and the speed at which it operates can go up to 30 meter per second, which means it's still subsonic, low speed. Now, the turbulent intensity is a parameter that determines how dirty or how clean your airflow is. So suppose you have a turbulence intensity of 10% and you have a mean flow of 10 meter per second. That means your flow actually fluctuates between 11 and 9 meter per second. The W tunnel has a turbulent intensity of about 0.5%, which is very low, making it a very clean and good wind tunnel. Now, Kushal will explain the different parts that are involved in making a wind tunnel work.
Let's start with the source of the flow, which is the fan.
The fan creates the required pressure gradient for the fluid to flow throughout the wind tunnel. And there are a lot of parameters that determine what kind of fan that we have to use, like the maximum velocity that we need in the wind tunnel or the size of the wind tunnel. The fan also adds a lot of turbulence to the flow. But our aim here is to have as smooth as flow as possible. That is, you want to remove the turbulence. And that is done subsequently in the next parts of the wind tunnel. The first part is the diffuser. If you look closely, the area increases in the diffuser. That means the velocity reduces. By reducing the velocity, you reduce a little bit of turbulence that is in the flow. But then there is still turbulence remaining in the flow, which is then removed in the settling chamber. And in the settling chamber, you have meshes. A lot of these which reduce the turbulence even more, and the fluid flow now moves into the contraction. And here, if you observe closely, the area reduces. That means the fluid velocity increases again. After the contraction is where you have the very important section, that is your test section, and it is in this test section that all the experiments that you need are performed.
Yo, shall we fire the wind tunnel?
Fire it. As I already explained, the flow coming out of the test section is highly laminar, and there are a lot of ways to test whether the flow is actually laminar or not. But a first preliminary test would be by using a tuft. A tuft is nothing but a piece of thread that is attached to a rod. And when you place the tuft in a wind tunnel where the flow is coming out, if the flow is laminar, the tuft is straight, whereas if it is turbulent, it keeps oscillating. Now let's check whether the flow is laminar or turbulent.
Alright, so you might have the question that this test section looks pretty small, so what test can you actually do? Suppose you want to test an aeroplane or a car or even a bike in a wind tunnel. Well, you scale it down. It means you reduce the size of the object so that it fits in the wind tunnel. Or
we get ourselves a bigger wind tunnel.
OpenJet facility, or the OJF as it is called here in the university, is a closed loop wind tunnel, and the size of the test section is enormous. But what I mean by closed loop is that the same air is being recirculated again and again to perform your wind tunnel tests.
The OJF, or the OpenJet facility, is used to test large objects. Here, even full-scale cyclists have been tested. Now, you'd be surprised to know that the velocity in this tunnel is the same as the velocity in the W tunnel that we showed you earlier. The maximum velocity, that is.
But what do when we have to test objects at supersonic or transonic speeds?
We get ourselves a supersonic wind tunnel.
Supersonic wind tunnel is used when you want to reach speeds above Mach 1. This wind tunnel operates between Mach 1.5 and 3. Now, you might notice that the test section of this wind tunnel is pretty small compared to the OJF and the W tunnel we showed you. This is because you have to accelerate air to such high velocities that the mass flow rate is inevitably low, and you can't have test sections that have huge areas. So a supersonic wind tunnel is different from a subsonic wind tunnel, obviously because of the velocity and also in the construction. In a subsonic wind tunnel, we saw that these wind tunnels had fans which let the air flow continuously. But a supersonic wind tunnel, it's not really possible to do that. So what you do is you store the air in a pressurized tank, and whenever you need to use the wind tunnel, you let air flow from the pressurized tank throughout the wind tunnel. We want to give a huge shout out to the faculty at the Aerodynamics Lab for letting us use these facilities, and hopefully you learned something about wind tunnels today.
Thanks for watching. We hope you enjoyed the video. And finally, don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Bye!